Right, good morning. Ready to start? Just to clarify, this is marked as a beginner session, and we're hoping that people want to focus on beginner session. But if it turns out that people want more advanced topics, we are happy to kind of shift gears and get into more advanced topics. But just trying to clarify that this was marked as a beginner session. Vivek and I work together at Hike Messenger. How many people have heard of this company? Hike? All right, that's pretty cool. So both of us worked at Hike, where Vivek was leading the QA automation, test automation team, and he basically set up the entire test automation infrastructure, everything. So it'd be cool to kind of work with him on this presentation, where we'll be sharing some of the lessons we learned from Hike, but also over the last 15 years of doing CI, things that we've learned, and so kind of trying to summarize that. I happen to be on the first, anyone's aware which was the first CI server? Cruise Control? Nope. All right, so Cruise Control was the first CI server that was ever built back in 2003, 2002. I happened to be on the team that built that. It really was a cron job that someone came up with, and then that's kind of how it ended up being a server, and then lots of things happened post that. Martin Fowler wrote about it, and then it became really big. So if you can just move to the next slide, please. How many people use some kind of a CI system at work? Just quick show of hands. All right, awesome. Pretty much everybody, right? So this diagram should be no surprise to you. Yes? Basically, you have a bunch of engineers, developers, testers checking in stuff into the version control. Once you check in things into version control, it could be any kind of version control. I'm assuming Git is the most popular one that most people should be using, but SVN, whatever, CVS, if anyone's still using that. You can check in code into any of your version control. You have your CI server, which is essentially monitoring your source control, and as soon as a new update comes into the source control, either a PR, a pull request, or someone makes a commit, then essentially it would take the latest stuff from there, build it, run run a bunch of tests, package it, do some analysis on it, and do a various different set of steps, and finally publish some kind of a report to let people know that the last change that was pushed to the version control, what is the state of it? Is it good? Is it bad? Should people continue on it or not? Right? That's kind of, in a nutshell, the idea behind CI, or continuous integration. And again, I'm hoping everyone's familiar with this concept. We're going to go deeper into this. What does this mean? What are the different stages? What are kind of some of the challenges? And kind of go through that. So if we move to the, anyone's heard of Andon? One person, all right. Where does this concept of CI come in? Software people usually copy things from somewhere else, right? So we copied this concept of CI from somewhere else. Has anyone heard of the Toyota production system? Right, all quality folks usually would have heard about it, because it's kind of one of those things that everybody talks about in the quality world. It's kind of the state of the art if you're talking about quality. So the concept of CI actually comes from Andon. Andon is a Japanese word where essentially it means, what happens is, if you think of a typical assembly line, like imagine you're in a Toyota production system, there's an assembly line on which the cars are stuck. And each person in the assembly line is doing something to the car, like someone's fitting some piece of equipment, someone else is tuning some piece of equipment. So there's a big assembly line, the cars are moving at a steady pace, everyone's just basically doing their piece of work, the next guy does the next piece of work, and it kind of keeps moving on. If a guy spots that something is wrong, for example, someone notices there's a drop of oil on the floor, right? Something is not usual. So there's a cord on the top. They basically pull that cord. It stops the assembly line, right? And basically they pull everyone together. They say, hey, look, there is something unusual. What happened? They do something called as the 5-why to do a root cause analysis of why is this. And then hopefully they find the root cause, they fix the root cause, and then they let the assembly line move forward. Right? That's the concept of add-on and on, which is kind of what inspired people in the software world to say we need a similar system in software, right? What does this mean? What's the assembly line equivalent in software? Different developers, testers are pushing in their changes, right? That's moving it at a steady pace to go into production. And what we have is a CI system that we have set up, which basically analyzes as these changes are coming in. If something is not right, then it stops the production line, which basically means stop. You can't keep now pushing more changes. This is not going to go forward until we fix this. Unfortunately, a lot of people just fix it and move on. The idea is actually to understand why this occurred, so hopefully you mistake-proof it and does not happen in future. Right? That's the real idea of CI, and how you improve quality by doing CI is actually not just fixing and letting the build go, but actually doing a root cause analysis and trying to figure out or mistake proof such that this thing does not happen again in future. And that's how you're kind of building quality in to the process rather than leaving it till the end. Make sense so far? Everyone's with me? All right, cool. So that's the stop the production line culture. If you go back to your company, you may see someone using like CI is like, we want to stop the production line culture. So hopefully you will be able to explain what that actually means now. All right, with that, let's look at a real world example of what a CI system looks like in, at least in our case. Probably all of you have seen this in your own respective companies, but here's a quick demo of what it is. So Vivek, over to you.
Thanks, Naresh. So would like to start with a real-world example that we implemented at Hike. So CI starts whenever a developer starts pushing code to the your version control system. So as soon as you make a commit to the main branch, or you may raise a PR to the main branch, there's a webhook that works in place on the version control, which sends ping to your CI system, and then all the stages that are running on the CI system are getting displayed on a version control. This is specifically Git. So here you can see number of checks that are running on the PR along with the status that are there. And quite to note here, and the merge pull request button is like off until all the checks have been passed, similar to the end on line that we discuss now. One of the best thing there here that we have done is running few benchmark tests, which is like the performance test over here, and some end-to-end integration tests. So as soon as a developer push a PR to the main branch, this is what's the status on the PR. Just to show, as soon as this is running off regression test on a lab. So on the first state, we saw the PR being pushed to the version control system. From there, the request went to the device lab. Here, all the integration tests are being run. And once the whole tests are complete, all the validations are being done, the CI system pushed back all the feedback to one place, that is your PR, because that's what the developer, that's the easiest way to find all the feedback on the PR. And so here, the end-to-end test failed, and the report is directly being pushed to your PR, which basically blocks your pipeline. And it says, why? Because it found a crash with number of tests failing. And so once you find this, like how many tests have failed on my particular code changes because of my particular code changes, and you can directly see the app crashed with my changes being pushed to the main branch. And then this is how, so once you find failures and crashes on your PR, the link is there, which basically have all the reports. So it basically gives information about the PR on which the report being executed, the build ID, and the, all the test info. Here, if you see the test that has been crashed, you click on that test, and it gives you the video of the running test, including your test logs in, and device logs to find basically at what particular point of time your app crashed. So the idea over here is to define the traceability of the runs, the whole report. So it gives you a basic idea on how your runs are looking, looks like, in what all devices it is running, how many number of times the test has been retried on a particular phone or on a different phone. So this gives you basically an idea on how the whole running test onto the PR, running end-to-end test on the PR, and how the reporting structure looks like.
So far, everyone with us just wanted to give you a real-world example. We'll now jump into a demo and kind of show you step-by-step what actually happens and kind of deep dive into it. But so far, is this something that is similar to what you're doing at your work? How many people actually push stuff back on the PR itself? Couple of folks. If you're not doing that, we would certainly recommend that you set that up that way, because you know there's one place where your engineers can go and look at things instead of having to go to multiple different places. And whoever's basically approving the pull request, it just becomes much easier for them to have all the information readily available on the pull request itself. So that way, it's just efficient for people to kind of work in this manner, right? So. Yeah, there are, so all of GitLab, GitHub, Bitbucket, all of these have plugins that allow you to integrate with whatever your CI system is and allow you to push your results back. Now when we show the demo, we'll actually deep dive into some of these things. We've also built some other interesting things like PR Risk Assessor and so forth, and we'll also demonstrate that in a minute. Yeah. Right.
So before we start on a demo, just want to put up a question. How many of you are running your end-to-end integration test on the PR?
Few folks, nice. Okay.
Okay, so we'll quickly start with a demo on how we have built end-to-end pipeline both for Android and iOS. So I'll quickly start with it. So we have created two pipelines over here. One is specifically for Android, and another one is for iOS. We'll quickly start with Android, and this is just a Blue Ocean plugin for Jenkins, which gives you a good view of the same. So here I have all my Android code on my local. Can you guys see it at the back? Okay. So what we gonna do over here is we gonna trigger, there are multiple strategies that you can follow on running, executing your CI. One is running on every commit, running on every PR. That all depends upon the strategy that you are following. So here, the demo is completely on running CI on each and every commit. So just here, we'll just try to add one file. Cannot see it. Okay. Yes. So this is the code that we have. I'll just try to add one file. I'm not trying to make any changes on the code right now, but this is the idea is just to show how the change in the repo triggers the CI. So I'll just try to add one test file over here. And just make some changes. So now you add these changes to your So here it made a commit to the main branch, and now if we shift to a Jenkins, so this is the pipeline that got cleared as soon as the test, as soon as the changes is pushed to the main branch. So this is how a CI pipeline looks like. So I would take some time to go through each one of the single stage. So first is the checkout code. So it depends upon how you are like running a CI. If it is a PR, you take the PR and merge that code on top of master. This is what happens over here. Then you compile the code because you might not take chances whether. So here, one of the advantages that we found was the source code is completely compilable. But once you remove few IDs from the source code, your test code becomes start throwing compilation error. So this is the place where you can like check compilation on your whole project. And then comes the stage where we test everything. There are a few stages that we have added over here. One is static code analysis. We'll talk about it in later stage. Next, you run unit tests and some part of lint. Then once this validation pass, it moves to the next stage where it collects data from all the static code analysis that we have done and basically creates a report and push back to your PR again. And once all these passes, it basically builds your APK, builds your application. It can either be an APK or IPA. And once the build is successful, what we do is we try to run integration tests at this point of time. And here the build stays only build a testing, so-called testing build, not the build for all the architectures. Since Android has like multiple like x86, you have to build for ARM, and all these architectures, plus it again comes with a number of flavors, right? So here we are just building it for testing for integration purposes, and it triggers, it moves to an integration and perf test stage where we do some integration tests, which are real Appium tests running on the pipeline. And then we also run performance tests. Just a note over here, these are not CPU, memory, and battery tests. These are like application performance tests that we call. For example, few P0 metrics like app launch, how much time it takes your app launch app to launch, and any code change that you pushed into your main branch is not making, is not like increasing this threshold. So it checks over here. If anything fails, your PR gets blocked, and the last part is reporting. So reporting is something which collects all the data from all the stages and then push it back to your GitHub, GitLab, or any other version control. So yeah, so we have right now, just for demo purposes, we have committed few of the code because building the application will take time. So we have taken the build directly over here. So integration and perf tests are over. I would like to like trigger it once more. So this is the real device that we are running our Appium test on CI, right? So right now for demo purpose, we are running on a single phone. We'll like later on come up with what all challenges that we have faced and what's next on this. So I'll come up, I'll come with those in the next slides. So guys, some of this visor is not working, and this is something, just a basic calculator app that is running your Appium test. And once the stage is over, it basically, you can see here on the logs, so it finishes, it, the reporting is done. At the same time, if you go to your GitLab, and go over here, you click on commit. So this is the status that you get. All the status are being pushed real time. So simple way to go over here is directly go to Jenkins, you go over here, and you are directly So this is where you land from directly from your version control system. So this was for Android. I would like to put one more sample for iOS. And let me start it. So just like Android, we have one more iOS test app over here. So this is again the repo that I have cloned on my local, and just like another adding one more file just to see whether it triggers the iOS pipeline or not. You commit back to your main branch. So here you saw a few of like pre-commit checks that ran. Again, we'll see why. Again, we'll discuss on why we have used this over here, just to put up some difference. Something's wrong over here. So somehow it's so I'll directly show you the pipeline that. So similar how the Android pipeline got executed, this is the iOS pipeline that we have created. You just say run. Here it almost follows, the stages are almost same. The underlying tools might be different. So for example, on Android it's lint, and the similar for iOS it's OC lint. And test here, you run all your XC tests, you run all your XUI tests, you run your Appium test over here, and yeah, this is how it works. So as soon as it comes to integration and perf tests, started running tests. Yep. So it started a simulator for iOS. Started doing some action. Again, it's a sample calculator application. So it just do 1 plus 2 equal to 3 and verifies it on the UI. And if you go back, once it finishes, you get the status over here. And the same is being pushed to your version control system. Going back to this, so any questions over here on how we ran it, how we added it?
Yep.
Sometimes in some areas the failures would be
in the
demo. Okay. So
we've we've skipped that stage right now because for the demo.
Right now for demo purposes. Yes. So there are.
No, you wouldn't skip stages in real world. We've just done that for demo because compiling will take a while. No point trying to sit here and compile.
And
but ideally, none of these should skip. If it skips, it basically means something's wrong, right? The idea is that all these should be green.
And it's simply we skipped it on iOS because it takes a lot of time to like compile the code, right? So for Android we did it. For iOS we'll just like for demo purposes.
Yeah, good question. So basically his question is that if I have made a change, then can we target a specific set of tests to run for that? That's something that we're going to discuss in terms of strategies of how to speed up your build and how to get feedback early. So just hold on to that. We will cover that. Someone had a question here. How long it takes to get
the
feedback?
In the real world examples, normally how long does it take?
Yeah, so for this particular sample, we were able to give feedback back to the developers, including running around 175 to 200 and under 30 minutes. And somewhere when we expanded our mobile device lab infrastructure, including both in-house and the cloud providers, we were able to bring it down to 20 minutes. So within 20 minutes, any change that is being pushed to your main branch, you get the report for the same.
So hold on to that question. We'll come back. Too early to jump into that question right now. But we'll come back to that, the difference between real devices, cloud providers, simulators, or emulators. We'll discuss that in a further section. All right? Yeah.
So I'm just interested to know what sort of scalability you're working with in terms of like developers inputting and having this as a one more thing slowing down a build. And what sort of success you've seen it working with? Like, does it work with 10? I guess be looking at it to work at a scale with like 70 to 80 people inputting and adding another 20 to 30 minutes and a potential blocker is going to be a bit of a hard sell, despite the fact it's kind of what we're after.
So his question is basically, you know, at what scale? So at Hike, we were about 120-ish engineers working on this. Fairly large setup in terms of the test infrastructure and things like that. You know, again, there were specific reasons why everyone bought into this. We will talk about why CI in the next few slides, what convinced people and how it actually helps them. So your question is valid. There are a lot of times when there will be pushback for things like this, and this is where we will try and cover like what will hopefully help people understand and see the value in this, all right?
Yeah, hi. My question is, when you run your CI, what all you take into account? It's just the functional testing, or you do performance and other tests that would be applicable for that?
Hold on, we will cover that.
Sure, thank you.
So far, I think let's move on because there's a lot more interesting stuff. We're just scratching the surface. Honestly, we were supposed to finish this in 10 minutes. Because there's a lot more interesting things in terms of what kind of you know, challenges you will run into, what kind of decisions you need to take, when you will run on a simulator, when will you run on cloud, how would you distribute. Those are the kinds of details we want to get into, right? So just hold on to questions for now. The demo made sense? Yes? So far? Good? All right. So let's look at this thing. All right. So stepping back, right, if you look at how an overall CI system looks like, this is kind of giving you a zoomed out view of what a CI system would look like. The demo only showed you like maybe 10% or 20% of that, right? But there's actually much more to a CI system. So if we actually step back all the way. So what's happening locally on a developer or a tester's machine, right? So essentially, they're making coding a feature, Once they code the feature, as they code the feature, they're obviously running unit tests and component tests. They are running static code analysis on their machine. Usually you can integrate with your IDE and it can start giving you static code analysis feedback as you're developing. And then you run some pieces of functional tests, which basically are the changes that you're making. So if you're working on a feature, you know it's going to be touching this piece of functionality. And so you're running those functional tests locally on your machine. So once this all looks good, that's when basically you will raise a pull request. And once you raise a pull request, basically what happens? Basically, the static code analysis on the chain set is triggered. Once the static code analysis is successful, then you essentially, these are not parallel. What is put in that box is essentially kind of sequential. These two are sequential. Static code analysis on the chain set that you made is also done on the server. Now, you may ask why you're doing it again on the server if the developer is already doing that over there. It's essentially to keep a consistent version on the server side, on the CI server, to make sure that you can see how, you know, static code analysis results are across all the builds. We run all the unit tests because, again, you know, the developer may have run, may not have run. Ideally, they should be running, but, you know, on the CI server, we will run everything. And then it would be ready for code review. We also do some automated code reviews, and we'll show you how we do some automated code reviews. But then there will be a manual code review where someone will look at it. And then if everything looks good, they will merge the pull request onto your master or trunk, whatever you call it. And once that is done, then we trigger the build on the main line on the trunk, which is what essentially goes into production. That then runs the component test, the sanity test, you know, basically after instrumenting your code. This is, you know, if you're running all kinds of static code analysis in this phase, dynamic code analysis, sorry. Then you run your functional test cases. And then if that is successful, it would basically trigger, in our case, a nightly regression, which would run the entire regression suite, do a full static code analysis on the tool, do benchmark tests, performance tests, dynamic analysis in detail across the entire product line. And then eventually, if everything is successful, it'll basically produce your APK or whatever your artifacts are and put it in. In our case, we were using for storing all of this, just the next one. So whatever your consumable artifacts are, basically certified them and put it in Artifactory, that's what we use. So from there, basically anybody could take the latest build that is produced nightly. And this is also something that would actually get shipped into production. So the nightly builds will build for each architecture, would do all of those kinds of things, so it's ready. So effectively, every night you have a certified build that is ready to go. We'll also talk about, now this is not the end of it, we've actually further gone ahead, and you can in fact automate the rest of the pipeline where you can even upload it into, you know, whatever your, you know, if you're using, again, different ways of deployments, but you can push it into App Store and things like that. You can start deploying it to 1% of your users. You can start monitoring the data that's coming in from there. If everything looks good, then roll it out to the rest of the users. So the entire pipeline essentially is automated. We want to stop here because here we are only talking about CI. That starts getting into the continuous deployment stages after this, right? So just roll back, hang on. Just go, so far, this is kind of a zoomed out view of what a CI system would look like, you know, in a typical workplace. What are our functional tests? So we have three different levels of functional tests. We have acceptance tests, which are, again, driven through Appium or other kinds of tools. Then we have workflow tests, which is essentially takes a whole workflow, not just a piece of functionality, but like, for example, a new user comes on board, walks through the entire onboarding process. And then there is UI tests, which is basically offline mode, online mode. You know, if someone goes offline, how does this look? If you change the orientation, how does it look? So all of those we categorize as functional tests. Workflows are also UI tests, right? Yes, these are UI tests. Where are you?
So
we are only talking about client side here. Similarly, there is a server side build for this, right? And similarly, the server-side builds will be going on, and that's where, you know, what we call as component tests here. So if you notice, we are calling it component. So an API test would fall into a component test for the server sides. Hang on, let him complete, then we'll come. How many PR requests we get every day on an average?
On an average, we get about 50 to 55 PRs. Average over like. Yes.
Maybe more than twice.
More than twice.
Hang on, we'll come to that. You know, what's the point? There's a lot of importance, right? It's like saying basically, you know, I have JavaScript on my client side, so I'm not going to do any validation on the server side. Let these people send stuff to the server, right? No, you can't do that.
But it should be at the dev level. Why is it at the CI/CD level? Because unit tests are not meant for the CI/CD.
What if someone forgot to check in a file?
Then even that will not get cached in your CI/CD system.
Why not? Because your test will fail, right? If it doesn't have dependency, why are you writing that?
So there can be independent classes, right? You can't have everything dependent on each other, right? The classes, let's assume I'm checking a class which is, it doesn't need either input, either output, and it's performing its own functionality at the top. It will always go and pass.
I mean, in 15 years, I've not seen a class that just sits outside, has nothing implication on any of the other application. Just seems very hypothetical. But I'll cut you out now because I don't want to get into an argument. Let's go there. Someone had a question. You have to speak up louder. If the PRs are dependent, how can two PRs be dependent on each other?
Yeah, so there is a backend and there is a UI. And so nowadays, like
backend and UI changes.
Right.
That's fine. We will talk about that when you have backend and UI. How do you handle that? Typically, the backend builds go first, and then the UI builds typically run after that. There is a green-blue deployment on the client side that we on the server side that we do. So the latest build from the server side is what your this CI will point to. We have a slide later which we will discuss that is
before merge you would be talking about?
Before merge, of course. Because if an API has changed and you have changed your UI code to react to the new API, then obviously if the server side is not available, then your build will fail.
Right.
So obviously they have to be synced.
Suppose 52 PRs per day,
not before release.
So if the first PR failed, then other 51 PRs in block, right? So
correct.
How you manage that until the first one go, these 51 we can't merge, I think.
So stop the production line culture?
That is the basic
premise of CI, right? Why is this failing? You want to go to the root cause analysis, try and understand that. And even if 51 are blocked, it's okay because you want to make sure that this mistake does not happen over and over again. What a lot of companies do is they just take this request outside and then let things go. But then you will see this behavior consistently happening, right? And so what you want to do is try and address that, you know, if there's a breakage, you kind of address that, you know, you do root cause analysis on it. It's okay to block. What you will notice over a period of time is your number of breakages will become a lot less because everyone knows that it'll block everybody else.
Yeah. So we have to finish this process much earlier before release, I think, right?
So we are saying a lot of stuff needs to happen on local dev environment,
okay.
Right? Yeah. If they don't do it, then it gets caught here. What you don't want is in a position where people are just chucking in code, which there is no way to verify the quality of the incoming code, right? So we want to make sure that whatever is getting into the main trunk, your main branch, is always in a deployable state.
Okay.
Right? I'm sorry, we can take too many questions and not get to the core of the topic. I'm happy with that, but you know, that's...
Can I just ask you the point where the Appium tests sit on your diagram?
So that's there, locally run. That's
and
here.
Locally, and that's on the second one, it's on CI, right?
Yep.
Then you do the merge. But we also have done some changes where we may run, you know, part of it before we do the merge as well. Depends, so that's where we'll get into more details. Depends on what kind of change you have made. You don't need to run Appium tests for every change that is made, right? And this is how you speed up your build. And this is where we talk about some CI strategy and things like that. All right, so the question was asked earlier is like, why, you know, why bother, right? How many people have this question? Otherwise, we can skip this. Nobody? Few people? All right. We'll try and cover this very quickly. So if you jump to the next slide, how many people have seen this in your company? Once in the last 12 years. Perfect. What about the next one? Not many people. But you often see that, you know, things are kind of not everyone's in sync, and then that's visible too late. And by that time, you don't have enough time to kind of fix it. So you just, you know, kind of say, we'll fix that next release. Let's move on. And that causes a lot of different kinds of problems. So effectively, I mean, I can talk about a lot more reasons, but what we are trying to do, the mindset we are trying to create here, is to essentially get feedback as early as possible so we can try and, you know, fix things as soon as possible. And we're not building on broken things, which basically makes it very hard to fix stuff later, right? So detect something is wrong as early as possible, and that's kind of what people talk about as this whole shift left mentality. So try and pull things as early as possible. So instead of waiting for people to finish the entire feature and then integrate, why not start integrating pieces of the feature as early as possible, right? Instead of waiting to run performance and regression tests till the entire thing is over, why not start running them, you know, as early as possible? So the whole idea is do things as early as possible, get feedback as early as possible so people can course correct and have enough time. And, you know, once you start doing this, what you notice is because your feedback cycles are improving, your delivery, overall delivery time is essentially reducing. You're catching things much faster. You're getting feedback much faster. You're getting people to collaborate more effectively when you start doing these things. You also see there's a lot of reduction in wastage. For example, two different sets of developers kind of trying to change same file in two different directions and then having to roll back and do things like that. So you start getting this kind of a feedback, especially if people are raising 50 PRs every day, then a lot of this feedback is coming in early. People are collaborating much more effectively. And finally, you will see that the overall quality of your product is going up because you're building quality in and not waiting till the end, right? So that's kind of, in a nutshell, why we think, you know, this is important now, kind of going back into this and deep diving into some of these things.
Yes.
How much time do we have left? 20 minutes? 15 minutes, all right.
Okay. So just to do a recap on the demo, this is what the pipeline looks like. We're gonna specifically talk about static code analysis and static code analysis and the commit risk advisor, and how does it help various stakeholders which basically participate in like taking the code to production. And so first one is static code analysis. I found it very useful in like reducing my PR review time, and moreover, it makes me a better developer by automatically detecting areas which needs refactoring, and it also detects like duplicate code, look out for code smells, and basically helps me in maintaining high quality code. And running this on my local with every code change that I do, I'm getting a continuous feedback, and that's the like that's the end goal for why we are setting up the whole CI thing.
Again, shift left, right? Like instead of waiting for someone else to review and give you feedback,
so
you just get it
right now. So right now we are using Sonar, but there are a lot of tools that we have integrated on Android front. One is PMD, one is Info from Facebook, and there are other tools that are already in market that we can just plug in to our CI system and we can get a report. I would suggest better, it's better to take the rules from all those tools, integrate in one, and keep it on the Sonar so that Sonar keeps track of each and everything, and all the rules are defined at one common place.
There's pre-commit hooks that you can define, and in pre-commit hooks, it can reject code that does not meet. When you're committing, when you're committing. And you can also integrate with your IDE some of the static code analysis so you can get the feedback. So for example, WebStorm has a pretty good intelligence that it has built in, and maybe Visual Studio Code, it doesn't have as good, right? So what you can do is you get plugins that can allow you to do this. In some cases, you may not have plugins in the IDE, but you can have command line tools, CLI tools for things like this, which can, for example, Sonar. You can actually run from a CLI Sonar command, and that will run all the rules locally before you actually commit things. And you can make it a developer habit that they do this regularly so that they don't get a surprise last minute. Again, this whole idea is to build the shift left mentality. So try and get feedback as early as possible instead of waiting till the end. And by that time, you would have done a lot of work, and then you have to do a lot of rework because of that.
So going back to this commit risk advisor, so as previously discussed, what we are doing here is collecting all the feedback from various static analysis tools and various other analysis. And this is something that we push back to Git. What all files that have been changed, what all modules, what all files have been changed, what are the metadata of that files, and what is the complexity, what is the code coverage. So idea over here is whenever you are submitting your PR for review, reviewer looks into this and basically helps you in identifying how much time you want to spend in reviewing this particular PR, how much risk this PR will bring into your main branch. So this is how it looks like, and the best thing that you can get from here is like the Sonar. It gives you a wonderful report. So we have pretty much covered on like how a basic CI infrastructure looks like and how the CI infrastructure looks like from a very high level. Like everything clear till now, and any questions?
Any questions? Yep. Let's get into the next section because I think that's kind of the important.
So yeah, so that CI system.
Whatever was marked as component tests, those are our API tests.
So this was for the mobile, and when it goes down to server, the API tests.
No, unit tests are unit tests, component tests are API tests for server-side code. For Android or iOS, it would be a component that you're essentially testing in isolation. You're not actually bringing, so you'd use, like, for example, RoboElectric for Android, and then you'd basically run that particular component, that particular activity, for example, and run tests against that, right? So it's a particular component. So you run those, if you're a server-side developer, then you're essentially running those locally, API tests locally. Then you're also running those here.
On your pipeline.
This is your entire API tests. And people talk about API tests and contract tests. They differentiate between those, right? So there's API tests and there are contract tests. Contract tests resides on the client side. In terms of how they're consuming an API. And so those tests also you would run on the respective builds of the consumers. So we call those also as component tests. We are using a little bit generic terminology to say, you know, these are all different kinds of tests that fit into your, you know, component tests?
So, yeah, so all the things that we had talked about comes with a lot of challenges, and at every moment you have to take some decisions, right? So, because we are running a business, the first thing that decision that we have to make is how much we're going to invest on this system. So there comes the cost, which has like a lot of parameters, how much you want to invest in building a mobile infrastructure of your own, you want to go to cloud infrastructure, you want to use Jenkins, or you want to go with cloud CI like Circle CI, Travis CI, and all those stuff. So it covers a lot of things. And how we reduce it,
Is cost a concern for people in their companies? Only one person, two?
Five.
Yeah, cost is one, time is these are all parameters that you have to balance out, right? Like you want to pay certain kind of money for a certain kind of frequency of feedback. So when it comes to cost, what kind of things you could play around with to kind of reduce the cost?
So just one answer, just save your resources, which includes basically how much machines you are like consuming while running your tests, or how much device, how much usage you are doing on cloud labs, how much usage you are doing in-house labs. How we handle it, I would like to talk about two main things. One is like test priority, and then another one is CI strategy. So in test priority, I think a gentleman asked a very good questions on which test to run when. So this is the priority that comes over here. And so each and every PR, so you analyze the PR and analyze which are the risk areas, which are the areas that this code can affect. And here comes the test prioritization. And you can always handle it using annotations or using a proper package structure over here.
Like you can use tags or things like that, but that's dependent on people's intelligence to categorize things correctly and things like that. But you can also do fairly simple but intelligent things. For example, if this test failed last build, does it make sense to run that first? Or should you go through the same order of all your tests and run it whenever it's supposed to come in? Right? So just by simply reordering your test based on which test failed last can speed up things and reduce your cost, right? This 2006, I built an open source project called Protest, which stands for prioritized test, which essentially looks at a bunch of different parameters to dynamically prioritize your test and execute them in that order. So the kind of things that we would do is we would look at which test failed last and prioritize them, which if you change a particular file, you build a dependency graph, and then you say if this particular file was changed, then any test that is basically dependent on this file, run those tests first before you run the other test. So again, these are all standard tools that are available these days. You can basically kind of get your prioritization done, but you can even write them very simply. You can look at essentially also categorize based on the time it takes. So you would want to run, if the two tests had same priority, then you might want to run the tests that run faster than the ones that run slower. So once you do these basic three or four things, you will notice that a 50% drop almost in the feedback time if things were to go wrong. I mean, obviously, if everything works fine, then it's going to take the same time. But if things were to go wrong, you'd start breaking out much faster. We'll catch up offline. Yep. I've been timed out. Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
We run out of time? Over time. All right. So we will be around. We will answer more questions. We'll hang out here. Sorry, we kind of took too many questions and ran out of time. But we'll be around. We'll answer more of these. The slides will go up, so you should be able to see the rest of the slides. We ran out of time. We just started with the most interesting pieces. This session didn't serve the purpose of beginners. That's what we were doing all this time. Now it's advanced topics. So far, what we covered was all beginner stuff, right? Like, why CI? What's the purpose? How do you do? You guys, you have to decide, right?